हेलो,
हेलो।
यस, आई कैन हियर यू. ग्रेट, थैंक यू. आई
या
थिंक देयर वाज अ
या
प्रॉब्लम विद माय हेडफोन. ओके ओके, सो वी कैन स्टार्ट. आई थिंक
या वी कैन
इट वुड बी गुड आइडिया टू म्यूट एवरीबडीज वीडियो एंड ऑडियो.
This is live streaming on YouTube as well.
Okay.
Yeah, we can. Yeah, just a minute. I will make you a host. The video is audio is muted, everybody except you, and
Okay.
I am making you a host now.
Okay.
Right, go ahead, Rupal.
Okay, should I start? Do
Yeah, please.
you want to introduce a little bit?
Yeah, I'll just. So, dear friends, it's great to have Rupal again on board today. And she had visited Raipur a few months back, and we had beautiful, beautiful interactions both in Awesome Group and the IAP platform. And she spoke extensively on weaning of children and lactation issues. And since then, I have shared her video with hundreds of mothers, which are so beautifully made. And she is doing a great original work on nutrition. And very happy to have Rupal you here. Please go ahead.
Okay.
So, just because we have already completed 100 number here, colleagues may not be able to get in now in this Zoom meeting. So I have forwarded the link for the YouTube as well. So people can just pass it on to their colleagues and post in the awesome group. So let's begin.
Sir, can you see my presentation?
Not yet. Please share the
Okay.
screen.
Okay, is it okay now?
Yeah, no, it's okay.
I'm going to start. Basically, today's topic is guideline for complementary feeding. And I'm assuming that we have a mixed audience. We have doctors, we have nutritionists, we have my mentor, Dr. Ratna Thar. I can see her. She's a nutrition PhD. And I can see a lot of mothers also there. So it is a mixed platform. So I'll try to be as simple as possible. But my focus was really actually pediatricians. So starting with definition of complementary feeding. Complementary feeding means Purak Ahar, you know. So how we were taught in medicine of weaning food, we don't call it weaning food. Weaning means something is going down and something is increasing. So in this case, you know, we are not decreasing the amount of breast milk that baby gets. Baby continue to get as much breast milk, but we are basically introducing children to complementary food. So, what are complementary food? Complementary feedings mean giving other foods in addition to breast milk. Okay, so anything that you start beyond 6 months, basically those are called complementary feedings, and these other foods are called complementary foods. An age is reached when the breast milk alone is insufficient to meet child's nutrition needs. Okay, so after 6 months, what happens is child requires a lot more nutrients, you know, besides what breast milk can give. And that's why it is important that complementary food is started at after 6 months of age. And I'll explain why. It also is used to emphasize that this feeding complement breast milk rather than replacing it. So that's why it's very important, Dr. Sawar, I know you have this thing of saying weaning food. We don't call it weaning food anymore. Okay, weaning means weaning is to go down, but we are not going down on breast milk. We are not replacing breast milk. We are just basically increasing nutrient density in child's food, you know, to meet the requirement. Why complementary feeding knowledge is critical? First of all, in our country, malnutrition is really rampant, you know, and it is responsible directly and indirectly for over half of all childhood deaths. And I'm going to show you a chart in my next slide, is that how rampant is this malnutrition. And also what happens is, you know, I've seen that a lot of complementary food which are started by mothers who are, educated, because they don't have awareness of what food to start, it leads to obesity and NCDs, non-communicable diseases. So that report also has come out recently, and I'm going to share that report also. So look at this. This is the your malnutrition by age and months in children under 5 years of age. So if you look at this underweight, which is your blue color, so look at the underweight. This is from 0 months till up to 16 months of age. So how literally from 0 to 6 months, you know, there is a sharp rise in underweight, and that is, of course, because of your inappropriate breastfeeding. And that's why we have prepared breastfeeding videos. If you don't have, if you have ineffective latch, you know, baby will not gain weight. And that's when after 6 months, when your food is not right, you know, the kind of food that mother start, if it's not appropriate for child's requirement, then your underweight continues to grow up. And till about 24 months of age, you can see it around 24, it peaks around 24 months of age, and then again, it goes up. So that's your underweight. Now with underweight comes your stunting. So as your underweight, now this is green color is your stunting. Stunting means your height or your length as per your age. So as underweight goes up, you can see the stunting starts. And stunting literally, you know, it starts, of course, you know, 0 to 6 months is very important because that's where babies grow the most. But after 6 months, you can see, look at the steep, increase in your stunting, which is a child's length. And at around 15 to 18 months, again, it peaks, and then it peaks again at around 30 months of age. So you can see that it's all because of your first year intensive nutrition is not taken care of. And then you can see the repercussion, you know, at around after 1 year of age. But the steepness starts, literally from birth. And your acute malnutrition, basically your wasting. Wasting is your SAM, MAM, you know. So as per your height, if your child is not gaining weight, that is your stunting. So your wasting, basically, you know, it is highest at birth. So between 0 to 2 months, it's the highest. And then basically, slowly, what happens, because the child is not growing tall, so then now child, weight for height or weight for length, it also decreases. So what I feel is that if we really take care of 0 to 2 months on lactation, then a lot of these problems will be solved. And also at 6 months, what happens if baby is growing really well, say from 0 to 6 months, those children have very good appetite, they eat well. And if mothers know what food to give, then these children become really, really tall. So that's what we saw in our program. So this is the CNNS report, which has come out, basically conducted by UNICEF with other agencies. And this is basically, conducted for Government of India. About 50,000 children from 1 to almost 19 years of age, we had done lab studies. Okay, so not only anthropometric measurement, and about 100,000 100,000 homes, they had done a survey, dietary survey, and anthropometric measurements on 50,000 children. So if you look at this all, this is your blue, light blue is 1 to 4 years of age. Your 5 to 9 years is your dark blue color, you know, that is your 5 to 9 years of age children, and 10 to 19 years of age, these are your basically your early teenage and teenagers. Okay, so if you look at this, the prevalence of the zinc deficiency is pretty predominant in 31% of children. Okay, that is in adolescent. And it's pretty high. 1 in 5 children have zinc deficiency. And, of course, as you all must have attended my lecture on type 2 micronutrient, zinc is a type 2 micronutrient. So if you have type 2 deficiency, your growth will suffer. Second one is the prevalence of vitamin A. So again, vitamin A is pretty, almost 1 in 5 children, they are vitamin A deficiency. They have vitamin A deficiency. If you look at your vitamin D level, so vitamin D level in your teenagers is pretty low. 1 in 4 children, they have low vitamin D level. Vitamin B12 is again, as you see, children are not getting adequate diet in their childhood and, pre-adolescent stage. And that's when you start seeing acute deficiency, when they grow up. This is folate deficiency, low serum ferritin, which is a low iron, and the prevalence of anemia. So if you look at anemia, look at our children between 1 to 4 years of age, 40% children are anemic, and this is your almost one third children are anemic in adolescent age, and children 5 to 9 years of age, almost 1 in 4 children. Now, that was more about undernutrition. Now I want to talk about non-communicable diseases, because I'm really concerned about non-communicable diseases, not only in adult, but also in children. So if you look at, this is the data of about 50,000 children. So this is all over India, okay? So if you look at if you know your glycosylated hemoglobin, right? Your hemoglobin A1C, it is indicative either of your pre-diabetes or diabetes. So if you look at your 5 to 9 years children, almost 10% children are pre-diabetic. So 1 in 10 children out of your 5 to 9 years of age, they are pre-diabetic. That is pretty severe, because here we are not even looking at your insulin resistant, because you may be your hemoglobin A1C could be very well 5.3 or 5.4, but it could be you completely may not be pre-diabetic, but if your insulin is high, then you are prone for pre-diabetes in next 5 to 10 years. Okay, and this pre-diabetic children, if they are not taken care of, then they basically, it results into diabetes. So about prevalence of of course diabetes, type 2 diabetes is low in children, but all these children, 10% up risk for going into diabetes, and other risk factor for basically getting metabolic disorder, it's your triglyceride level. So if you look at the prevalence of high triglyceride level, now triglyceride means your liver fat, okay? Your fat is storing excessive amount of fat, and that's where your triglyceride level goes up. Look at this number, 33 to 35% of children between 5 to 9 years of age have high triglyceride. That means the children are having excessive sugar, excessive fructose, and probably excessive carbohydrate. So the children need to have a lot more protein and good fat. So this is what our result are in 5 to 9 years of age. Prevalence of low HDL. So if you remember that your HDL is important to increase, that is your heart protective cholesterol. So look at this, it has to be high, but how many children have low HDL? 25%. And this is 5 to 9 years away. So that's what has happened, that the complementary feeding stage has gone wrong. And then after 2 years of age, children don't change their habit. Whatever they've been eating, if they're eating a lot more sugar, a lot more processed food, that's going to continue. And this is what these results are showing. Your LDL level, although LDL level nowadays is not much of importance in metabolic disorder, but still LDL level is high. Here now let's look at teenagers, 10 to 19 years of age. Now all these children, now what happens if the habit is not changed, then you will see the repercussion in older children too. Now problem with older children is that they do have a habit of ultra processed food, but a lot of this data is coming out from rural areas. So in rural areas, because of probably lack of adequate diet, you can see the triglyceride level has gone down. So, you know, triglyceride level has gone down, which is good. But that triglyceride going down, it's probably because they're not eating enough, you know. So obviously protein is also low, fat is also low. And then the amount of food that they need to eat, the nutrient, those are probably low too. And that's why triglyceride level go down. But, you know, once they grow up, say after 19, 20, they start to work. Then again, they start the ultra processed food, you know, like batata vada and samosas and all that would cause it a high triglyceride level. Okay. But one thing is important. Look at his HDL cholesterol, which is supposed to be high. But the prevalence of low HDL level in teenagers are also pretty high. So we need that height. And again, pre-diabetes is, you know, again, the same amount. So we need to work on this. And that's why I feel that this topic is really important, because mothers need to know. Can you hear me, Dr. Sabar?
Yeah, clearly. I can hear you.
Okay. Got it. All right. So then basically, all this habit starts from early on, okay? But mothers need to know what food to give and how to give and what are the quality foods which are important, okay? So if you have a complementary food which are of lesser nutritional quality, then what will happen? Up till 6 months, your breast milk is providing with all the nutrition that baby needs, right? So your complementary feeding that you're starting should be equivalent to your breast milk. So the nutrients which are present in your breast milk basically should be present in your complementary foods also. Okay, because if they are given an insufficient amount, what's going to happen is going to displace your breast milk. So, for example, if child is getting too many times complementary feeding, say around 6 months of age, but getting all watery food like watery rice, watery dal, then what?
Your voice has stopped. मैं नहीं म्यू आप अपने आप को अनम्यूट करिए क्योंकि मैं तो आप होस्ट हैं अभी
ओके राइट ओके 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 ऑलराइट सॉरी अबाउट इट आई डोंट नो देयर इज अ प्रॉब्लम ओके ऑलराइट सो आई एम बैक सॉरी Also, one more thing is important that we have to understand that baby's stomach is extremely small. So the gastric capacity is really small. So, you know, we have to kind of, you know, go accordingly. So we have to give a nutrient dense food. If you give watery food, that stomach will be filled with water. Okay. Then repeated infection reduces appetite. So all these children who are exposed to dirty water or, you know, maybe unhygienic food, then these children will be prone for infection. So that also we have to keep in mind. And infant and young children, they need to have a caring adult or other responsible person who is basically responsibly feeding the child a sufficient amount and with love and tender care. So what is appropriate feeding of young infant and children? Breastfeeding should start early within 1 hour. Okay, exclusive breastfeeding for 6 months. Appropriate complementary feeding should start from age of 6 months completion. Okay, and with continued breastfeeding up to 2 years. So this is really important because a lot of time what happens, doctors forget to say that, okay, continue breastfeeding. So what happens, they start, you know, cow's milk and that replaces breast milk. So this is important that before we go ahead with complementary feeding advice, it's important we talk about breastfeeding. Okay, and it should be timely, important, adequate. Okay, which I'm going to talk about, safe and hygienically prepared and stored and properly fed. Okay, so I'll go into detail. Why at 6 months of age? Because at this age, baby's digestive system are mature enough to begin digest a range of food. Okay, if you start before that, basically baby's gut is not mature enough and there'll be a lot of problems. We'll discuss what are those problems. So if you look at all this, this is the WHO slide on energy required by age and amount supplied from breast milk. Okay, so here this is your children from 0 to 2 months and 3 to 5 months of age. Black color is your energy from breast milk. Okay, so your nutrients and energy from breast milk. So up to about 5 months, 6 months completion, you have enough amount of nutrient and energy coming from your breast milk. Starting from 6 months to 8 months of age, what happens? Then there is an energy gap. Okay, so this energy gap, not only energy gap, but nutrient gap also. And that here, so look at 6 to 8 months, there's a energy gap about 200 kilocalorie. From 9 to 11 months, about 300 kilocalorie. And about from 1 to 2 years of age, you have a kilocalorie gap of about 550 kilocalorie of energy. Okay, and that's why to fill this, you need to have complementary food. But the complementary food that you're going to give it, it should be equivalent to what baby is getting in breast milk. Okay, so that is very important to understand the physiology. Okay, all right, now here look at the gaps to be filled by complementary food for 12 to 23 months of age. This is again a WHO slide. So if you look at the nutrient density, so from 1 to 2 years of age, energy is supplied, about less than half of energy is supplied by your mother's milk. Okay, the gap needs to come from complementary foods. Same thing about protein, about 50% is is supplied by breast milk. That should come from your complementary feed. Iron, breast milk iron is really low, but the bioavailability is very high. So make sure that babies take breast milk. I also do recommend personally, in the US, we give iron supplement from 4 months of age, to basically, because again, if you look at 6 months of age, if children are not getting high iron-rich food, they will definitely get iron deficient. And once your child is iron deficient, the damage is already done. So our goal is to really prevent iron deficiency anemia. Vitamin A, good amount of vitamin A in mother's milk. If you look at it, almost 70% of vitamin A is present in breast milk. But this is true if mother is latching properly. Because if mother is not latching breast milk properly, there is no proper breast milk transfer, and then you will have lot more energy gap in this. And this is what is happening in India. What's happening, because there is ineffective breastfeeding, latching is poor, milk transfer is poor. So right here, baby's not getting enough breast milk, and right there your energy is low from breast milk, protein is low, and that's where children are becoming malnourished right from birth. Okay, why at 6 months? As I said, baby's gut matures around 6 months of age. They require a lot more energy. They require protein. So they show interest in other people, in other people's eating and reach for food. They like to put things in their mouth. They control their tongue better to move. So, you know, they start developing this movement where they can basically, you know, have a more of a chewing movement. And, you know, there are all the different phases, which I don't want to go too much in detail. Okay. Start to make up and down munching movement with their jaw. So it's important to start at 6 months of age, because when they are drinking milk, or even if they are having, say, 6 months ke baad water, so the tongue movement is different than how they would eat when the food is thick versus how they would eat when the food is mashed with the hand, or how they would eat when the food is chunky. So it's all different phases. So you have to introduce those children at the right phase for them to learn how to do that. Okay. So what happens if we start complementary feeding too soon? Again, you know, it takes the place of breast milk. You know, it results in lower nutrient. It increases the risk of illness, as I said, because, you know, again, no food can be comparable to breast milk. Breast milk has a lot more, you know, life factors. So again, when we start outside food, you know, too early, it has less protective factors. Okay. Foods are not clean. They're difficult to digest. And also, of course, it increases mother's risk of pregnancy. What happens if we start complementary feeding too late? If we start too late, as you saw, there will be energy gap, there will be nutrient gap, there will be slowing of child growth and development. You know, it will cause deficiency, it will cause malnutrition. And another most important thing that we see all the time, the child is not started properly by 6 months of age, there will be rejection of solid food. Later you start, harder it becomes. And this is again from WHO. This is energy gap. So this energy gap is provided by complementary foods. Around 6 to 8 months is 200 kilocalorie per day. 9 to 11 months is 300 kilocalorie. And 12 to 23 months, about 550. Now, personally, myself, I don't believe in this calorie part. Okay, because if we tell mother the child requires about 200 calorie, 200 calorie can easily come from, say, sugary juice, right? So I believe more, the reason I'm presenting because it's part of WHO, but I believe it's more of nutrient density than just energy. Okay, so again, food consistency is really important. As I said, that young children have very small stomach. So if we give watery food, it will not provide enough nutrient density. Okay, so thick density is very important. Also your stomach size. So this is the stomach size, and this is about 10 months of age baby. So 10 months of baby has about 200 ml of stomach capacity. Okay, you cannot fill it completely. So even if child takes about, say, a half vati, which is about 125 ml, you know, but that 125 ml should be literally thick. It should not be watery, because if it is watery, your 100 ml will be water and 25 ml of food. That will be too little energy density, too little nutrient density. So that's why it's important to have a thick consistency. Okay. What should be the food consistency? At around 6 to 8 months of age, pureed nutrient dense food. Now, a lot of mothers, they do start with food which are chewable, but I am kind of being emergency medicine doctor. We see a lot of, choking, in the US, they come with choking. So I'm a little bit skeptical to start food which from 6 months of age, which are not pureed. You know, I mean, it is a trend right now, but I'm a little bit skeptical. So I do prefer to start with pureed food at around seven and a half months of age. You can make it mashed food, soft, chunky food, nutrient dense food. You can start finger foods. Okay. Snacks that can be eaten by children alone. I'll talk about it, what we can give. By 12 months of age, basically it's adult food. So whatever parents are eating, you know, table food, only thing you want to make sure that food should not be choking. Like, for example, do not give whole nuts, whole grapes, you know, raw carrots, anything which is hard. Okay, that you do not want to give it. One more thing, you want to make sure that all the children, they sit down and eat, because there is a habit, you know, they run around and parents run after them and they feed them. So we need to start those habits early on. What is a thick consistency? Basically, when you tilt it, the food should not fall off easily. Okay, it should fall off literally very slowly. So generally in Gujarati, we make something like puran poli, you know. So when we make puran poli, what we do is when we cook this dal, you know, we put a spoon in the dal, and that spoon should stand, you know, it should be that thick. Okay, so if it is watery, basically your spoon will not stick in there, it will fall off. So that's very thin. So this is important, and we have prepared a lot of IC material to show what should be the consistency. You know, okay, that's what I've talked about. The food should be thick enough to stay easily, as I said. Family use a blender to prepare baby's food. I don't recommend using blender so much, you know. I prefer that mothers can basically mash the food in the form of, if you have a grater, you know, and if you're giving, say, sweet potato, if you're giving a pumpkin, you know, a bhopla, just use the grater and then basically grate it. Okay, because when you grate that way, you don't require water to be used in the blender. Okay, so personally, I prefer that. Or if you have, you know, say, we call it kalbata, or even the stone grinder, you know, that mother can use it with hand, and that will not require too much of water. So try to use as little liquid as possible. If mother's breast milk is available, nothing like it. I'll talk about it later. Porridge, vegetable, meat stews. A lot of time, you know, mothers said, oh, I started soup. Now, when you're giving soup, literally when we have soup, soup is literally like water, right? And that's too thin. So you tell mothers that do not use words like dal pani, chawal pani, soups, you know, that kind of creates a confusion in mother's mind that, okay, it should be soup, so it should be like a watery. So I don't recommend, you know, using those words. Okay. Okay. Now, why do mothers don't give thick consistency? Because we do see that in community, that in spite of telling them that, okay, bahut ghada rakhna hai khana, bahut ghada rakhna hai, but they, mothers don't listen to us. And then basically, these are the reasons why mothers don't listen. One is your fear of choking. They feel that, oh, nahi, bachche ke daant nahi aaye. So, you know, that we have to explain to that. You tell mother to put her finger in baby's mouth. Okay, and when she does that, and when she realizes baby has such strong jaw that baby will bite on it, and then, you know, she'll say, ah. So you want to show them that, you know, the jaw is so strong that you don't need teeth to chew, actually. Of course, and this is all soft food, you know, so that we have to explain to them, and we have to kind of show it to them that, you know, you don't require literally you don't require teeth to chew. Then they have this fear that thick food is difficult to swallow. But again, you know, what we do is we kind of sometimes make in a clinic, you know, and show them. And when babies start eating and they swallow, you know, they understand, you know, it's easy to swallow. And they also have a fear of constipation. So they feel that, no, agar main bahut ghara dungi to constipation ho jayega. But, you know, what we say that, you know, immediately after food, within maybe 10-15 minutes, she can give her milk. And milk has so much of water in it, you know. So give, you know, breast milk, which will basically help with the constipation. And watery food is faster to give. So a lot of time what happens is, if mothers are working, and if, you know, obviously watery food is much easier to give, you know, just patafat de diya ho gaya. So we want to, you know, kind of touch base upon working mothers, you know, because they find it very easy to give watery food fast. Now, milk frequency is very important. Okay, so we want to give it, I'm going to go a little bit more detail in this here. This is the detailed chart. So starting from 7 months, so it's a 6 months completion. Okay, 6 months completion. So I'm going to start at the 7 month. Okay, 7th month, you start with 2 meals a day. You start with 1 tablespoon on day one. So what happens is you don't want to start like one half vati or half katori on day one, because again, this is called introduction. So introduction is like, you know, you start 1 tablespoon in the morning and 1 tablespoon in the night. Okay, same food. You increase slowly and steadily over next 2-3 days. So first day, 1 tablespoon twice a day, then 2 tablespoon twice a day, then 3 tablespoon twice a day. This way, if child is allergic to anything, you will know right away child is allergic. On day 4, what I do is basically I start decreasing this first food and then start the second food slowly. So if I'm giving, say, 3 tablespoon of, say, some pulse or some dal in the morning and 3 tablespoon of dal in the night, then what I would do is day 4, I will decrease from 3 tablespoon to 2 tablespoon and add something else. Like, say, for example, I want to add palak. So then I would add 1 tablespoon of palak and then 2 tablespoon of whatever dal that I've started. So basically at 7 months, it's introduction. And we don't like to go above 4 tablespoon twice a day, because more food you start, what it is doing is it is replacing your breast milk. Okay, I don't want the breast milk to go down, because if babies are getting good amount of weight gain by 6 months of age, say for example, my goal is 8 kg by 6 months. If your child is 8 kg by 6 months, you don't want to start too fast your too much of complementary food, because then you will see plateau in the growth. Okay, so start slowly. Then 8 months of age, you now give 3 meals a day, and now the quantity will increase. Remember, I told you that their capacity is not more than 200 ml. Okay, you cannot fill that stomach to 200 full capacity, or the child is going to throw up. Okay, so you want to start really slowly. So again, half cup a meal, 3 times a day. By this 1 month, you have probably introduced at least 8 new foods. Okay, it's more of not replacing the previous food, but adding. So by 8 months, child should be eating literally 8 to 9 different kinds of food, in a day, just in three meals. So you'll be combining a lot of different foods in the meal. Again, 9 months, you start adding one snack. So if you look at it, 2 months, two meals a day, 3 meals a day, 4 meals a day, 5 meals. So every month you start increasing the frequency, and, your quantity remains the same, half cup, 4 times, here one snack, so you can give one just a finger food. And again, at 1 year of age, it's 5 times a day, but your quantity increases. So now you're 1 cup of meal. Okay, so 1 cup of meal does not mean every time you have to give it in a cup. But for example, if you're given one egg is equivalent to your 1 cup. Okay, so if you're giving one roti is equivalent to 1 cup. Okay, so that's your frequency. Okay, now nutrient content of complementary foods, very, very important. As I said, your complementary should be equivalent to what nutrients are there in your breast milk. Okay, so if you look at your breast milk, basically it's all said and done, it's mother's milk, right? So very high in protein, good amount of your good fats. And so I do recommend that children, if they are non-veg, if parents are non-veg, that, these are again WHO slides. So meat, poultry, fish or egg should be eaten daily if mothers are non-vegetarian, or even anybody else is non-vegetarian. Okay, vegetarian diet cannot meet nutrient needs at this age unless nutrient supplements or fortified products are used, especially iron, zinc, calcium and vitamin B12. This is WHO specifically mentioned that this particular, all these micronutrients are deficient in vegetarian food. So you'll have to think of adding this food with something which are high in zinc, calcium. So for example, for calcium, we use kadipatta powder, kadipatta, which is which we have made those powders. Mothers can make it at home. That will add some more calcium. So you will have to basically supplement your complementary foods. Okay. Now, vitamin A-rich food and iron-rich food should be eaten daily, which is part of your minimum adequate diet. Calorie density, again, I don't worry too much about calorie density. It's more of nutrient density that I work on. Provide diet with adequate fat from natural food. So again, we have prepared all these powders, peanut powder, sesame seed powder, to start as early as possible. So if you started with dal, then the second food should be peanut powder or your sesame seed powder or any of those nut powder or seed powder, because it will immediately increase your nutrient density. All these foods are so high in nutrients, your magnesium, your good fat, your protein, it is high in sulfur, just name any, it has all the nutrients. So don't start apple puree. Apple puree has hardly anything but sugar. Okay, start food which child required to grow tall and required to have muscle mass. For muscle, they need protein, they need type 2 micronutrient growth factors, okay, growth nutrients. Okay, then avoid drinking, giving drinks with low nutrient value. So don't give tea, coffee. In our community, we have a lot of children who give tea, ya chai dete hai, ya to, kuch na kuch juice dete hai, sugary drink, they start even soda. In fact, it is a trend in rich mothers that they start with juice, so please do not give those, those are very high in sugar. So you know, start fruit, but start a little bit later, say after 8 months, 9 months, you make children used to having all different tastes, but sugar, but sweet taste. Okay, I really believe that, because once they start sweet taste, it will be very difficult for them to like bhaji. It will be very difficult for them to like egg, you know, so start with other taste. Okay. Now, fortified complementary food, vitamin, okay, this again, we have to, what I believe in doing food-to-food fortification, which we have made powders, which I'm sure, you know, I'll go through it. Ways to enrich food. Okay, now this is supplementing your complementary food. So as we know that most of our complementary foods are not rich in a lot of nutrients. Okay, so how are you going to make them nutrient rich? That is called enriching your food. Okay, so you basically prepare less with less water. What I recommend is to prepare again with either coconut milk or you prepare with breast milk. Okay, and these are the two most important liquid that you can use to prepare complementary food. Okay, when you're making any flour or if you're making say porridge, right, then you basically if you can you know, germinate and then basically toast it, you know, you roast it, then those cereals will require less amount of water. Okay, so that is important to basically roast your flour, roast your whatever flour that you're making. Okay, for a soup or stew, what I tell mothers, she can have whatever water that she wants, but baki ka jo raha hai, but problem kya hota hai ki I don't like this soup and stew at all, because when you remove the water part, all the minerals and vitamins and all this thing are gone in the water, you know. So I tell mothers ki don't basically make soup, just basically, you know, steam it and then make a grate it, and that's how you give it to children. Okay, so this is how we have now in WHO, they have recommend to a spoonful of milk powder, but I don't like it. It's basically, if you're using mother's milk, that's very much good enough. Okay, replace some cooking water with fresh milk, coconut water, coconut milk, cream. Mix a lot of this legume pulse bean flour with the staple flour before cooking. So that way, you know, this beans, pulses, legumes are very high in protein. That will be helpful. They are very high in minerals also. Okay. Then what I really like is this peanut butter. So if you can use this groundnut paste or groundnut flour or powder, you know, or sesame seed paste, those are extremely high nutrient dense food. So whatever mother is making, if she's making khichdi, tell her to put groundnut or you know, sesame seed paste. If she's making something else, she can put some other powder, you know. So that's how you can enrich your food. Now, oil and fats are concentrated source of energy, okay? So some people have the habit of putting oil in everything. What I feel is if you put too much oil, child required oil, there is no doubt about it. They required good fats. One thing is important, what oil you're using, okay? So if you're using oil which is very high in omega-6, so all your refined oils, you know, like your corn oil, canola oil, your sunflower oil, safflower oil, those will give very high amount of omega-6. Now, child is growing, child brain is growing. They required a lot more omega-3 fats, okay? Omega-3 fats they required saturated fat. So that's why even in America, we never say that go on low fat for children, you know. You give dahi de rahe ho, aap toh usko full fat dahi dena hai. Usko malai aap mat nikaliye. Theek hai? Cream is good, you know, malai, jo cream hote na, that you can add in baby's food. So rather than putting oil, if you want to put oil, you can put a little bit of coconut oil. Okay, so the MCT oils, those are pretty good, that is good kind of oil. But if you have to put fat, you can put a little bit of ghee. I think ghee is okay, but don't add any refined oil, that will cause a lot more problem. Okay. Okay. If the child is growing well, you don't require extra oil. Absolutely. You know, you focus more on protein and focus more on type 2 nutrients, which are magnesium, potassium, sulfur. Okay. Okay. And one more thing is animal source food like fish. So if mothers or parents are eating fish, please recommend to start fish from 6 months of age. Extremely high in omega-3, DHA, EPA. And child, definitely it helps with the IQ. There are a lot of studies which have come out that children required omega-3 fatty acids. If children are not eating fish, then it would be a good idea to start with, you know, maybe if if parents can afford walnut paste is okay, you know. Egg is another good source. Flax seeds are again a high in omega 3 ALA. So, you know, think of your good fats. Okay, your cholesterol is very important, so make sure that you know the child gets food which is high in cholesterol. So that is, your ghee is high in cholesterol, malai is high in cholesterol, coconut milk is high in cholesterol. Okay, fermented porridge. One way is to mix, again, fermentation is another very good way of increasing the nutrient density, and it increases absorption of nutrients, you know, from food. So fermentation is very important. Like hum log khate, we have dhokla, we have idli, you know, these are all fermented products. Okay, fermented grain. So make sure that whenever you're making any grain food product or recipes, you soak it for a good number of hours. Okay, what is the advantage of fermented porridge? Basically, fermented porridge are extremely, it is less thick than plain porridge. So you can add lot more grain or flour, you know, in the same amount of water. Okay, then children prefer taste of sour porridge. So they prefer more of dhokla rather than, if you don't expose them to, say, you know, sweet porridge, they will prefer sour porridge. It's much more healthier than putting any sugar or jaggery in there. Okay, the absorption of iron is better in your fermented porridge. Okay, and it is more difficult to grow harmful bacteria in soured porridge. Okay, so those are good bacteria which will be there in fermentation. Sprouts are very important. So when you're making any food for children, you make sure that you sprout them. When you sprout them, what happens is it basically decreases the phytic acid. Those are anti-nutrients. So you need to decrease your anti-nutrients in your grains and legumes, because if you don't decrease your anti-nutrients, what it will do, it will prevent the absorption of iron, magnesium, zinc, and calcium. So these are all the minerals. So basically, you know, if you're not decreasing anti-nutrients, your mineral absorption will go down and children will have deficiency. So there are a few cooking technologies that you can use in the house. One, as I said, soaking. Then I told about fermentation, then sprouting. These are all cooking technology that mothers need to know at home. So these are, again, you can sprout anything and everything. Okay. So rather than giving just plain masoor dal, you know, masoor, just germinate it and then cook it and then mash it. Okay. These are much better than just without germination. So look and see. You can see everything is germinated. This is your rajma is germinated. Your chole is germinated. Okay. This are all, again, your masoor. I think this is vatana. This is again germinated. Roasting. So make sure that after you germinate, and if you want to make flour of this germinated products, you know, your beans, then you roast it, or you dry it and roast it and then make a powder. So this is basically made from roasted legumes and grains. You see these powders? And these are basically homemade cereals, you know. Parents are ready to buy cereal, you know, Cerelac and kuch kya kya bana, matlab wo upar ghar ka jo banana hai wo nahi bana rahe, and they buy all these boxes, you know, which are probably sitting on the shelf for I don't know how long. Okay, so we want to kind of promote that if you want to make cereals, make it at home. Okay, you can store it for a week or so, aram se, you know, so mothers, they don't have to worry about it. And you make a porridge with mother's milk. This is mother's milk se porridge banaya hua hai. So you can basically look at this, so thick and so nutritious. And it's agar if you add a lot of nut powder, seed powder, you know, I mean, this is just amazing. Okay, germination also has more iron to be absorbed. Iron is a big problem, as I told you. Iron deficiency is very, very common. This is another amylase powder recipe which we have given in a tutorial. So I'm not going to go too much in detail about amylase-rich food. Iron-rich food is important. As I told you previously, that, you know, mother's milk doesn't have enough iron. Okay, up till 5 months, baby may have a storage in liver, and that is provided if we had cord clamping a little bit later, because, you know, a baby, a lot of doctors are clamping the cord within as soon as baby is born. So please let it pulsate, and once the pulsation is over, then you can clamp it, and that will increase the iron in child. And then basically up from 6 months of age, you require, look at the iron gap, it's pretty high, right? So you want to start that, iron-rich food. What are the food rich in iron? Again, non-veg is definitely high in iron. Bioavailability is almost 100%, you know. It's heme iron. So, you know, it's again, much better. So again, fish, eggs. If you're vegetarian, then all your seeds. seeds are pretty good. So your black sesame seed, your til, your this are halim seeds which you get in Maharashtra. Okay, pumpkin seeds, your sunflower seeds, all the leafy green vegetables. Only thing is leafy green vegetables also has very high in anti-nutrients, which are your phytic acid and your oxalic acid. Same as seeds. All the seeds are very, very high in anti-nutrients. So if unless you do those cooking processing on this food, children will not absorb enough iron. Okay. The way you process this is basically you just saute it, you know, cook it a little bit, you know, don't boil it, just saute it, and that will really reduce your phytic and oxalic acid. One more thing I do recommend is oxalates. If you don't process this spinach, for example, if you don't cook it, you know, that oxalate will get absorbed and it will cause eventually, you know, risk of oxalurea or oxalate stones are pretty common in adults nowadays. So I recommend, you know, and Dr. Ratna has also mentioned this many times, that we need to add food which is high in calcium with the food which are high in oxalates, so that calcium will bind with your oxalate and it will get excreted in the stool. Okay, so calcium oxalate, it's important that oxalate doesn't get absorbed. Okay, now this are again greens. So I'm talking more about the greens. You know, bahut sare greens hum log fek dete hain, we just throw it. Please do not throw it, you know, make sabji, make something out of it, you know. So all the dals are high in iron, again, but high in anti-nutrients. So you'll have to soak it, germinate it, all that you'll have to do, okay? And eat with dahi. Okay, so iron absorption, again, vitamin C is important for iron absorption. Iron from meat and fish is better absorbed than iron from plants and eggs. Okay, because in fish and meat, it is basically made, it is present in heme form. Okay, now, and that's why when you have eggs also, you'll have to have some vitamin C, and that will help with the absorption of iron. Even with plants, make sure to have some vitamin C rich food, you know, which will help. So vitamin C rich food is your tomato, broccoli, guava, mango, you know, whatever, any vitamin C. I prefer lime, just use lime. A small amount of flesh organ. If child is non-veg, then with plant, if they can eat any of this seafood or any of this, that will help. Seafood, I recommend after 1 year of age. So no seafood up to 1 year of age, because very high risk of allergy. Okay. And there's some high rich food, which is high in vitamin C. What will decrease the absorption of iron? Your tannins, okay, your tea, your lot of this fiber, you know, phytic acid fiber rich, you know, and your calcium. So if you're eating food which is high in calcium and high in iron, you know, most likely, basically iron will probably not get absorbed. Yes, if you're really iron deficient, these are competing, they compete. Either calcium will get absorbed or iron will get absorbed. So depending upon what deficiency you have, you know, that nutrient will get absorbed. But basically, it's important that, you know, we don't mix this two food. Safe preparation, I think everybody knows. I'm not going to go too much in detail. We have very good two tutorials on safe preparation of food. It's literally 10-15 minutes long, so it's a whole lecture by itself. Vitamin A, I'm going to talk about it, because that's what WHO recommend, that children should have vitamin A rich food. Okay, I'm going to go a little bit detail in it. What is responsive feeding? You give when child is hungry. Don't force feed the child, because when you force feed, it has you know, it has a negative effect. Okay, so it's important that, you know, we respect child's appetite and then basically feed them responsibly. Okay. Okay, feed slowly, patiently, you know. If child refuses many foods, you experiment with different food combination, taste, texture, you know. What happens is after seven and a half months of age, they hate puree. So if you're going to give puree after 7 months of age or 8 months of age, they're going to throw it out. So you want to make sure that, you know, you're not giving too much of puree after a certain age, because you have to go according to their developmental age. I'm just going to drink some water. Feeding during and after illness. This is really important. So what happens when the child is child has diarrhea or child has any viral infection or bacterial infection, they will not eat. It is pretty pretty common, but they would definitely breastfeed. So you increase your breastfeeding while child is sick, you know, and but give nutrient dense food. So whatever you're giving, you know, don't just give watery food, you know, just give nutrient dense food, because there is another myth that mother feels that, oh, my child has diarrhea. If I give more food, child has more diarrhea. You know, so we want to kind of make sure that, you know, mothers understand that there is something called starvation diarrhea. So if you don't feed children, they will continue to have diarrhea for a longer period of time. It's important to give ORS, important to give zinc, but continue breastfeeding, continue complementary foods, which are, you know, rich nutrient dense. Okay. Encourage child to eat soft, varied, appetizing favorite foods. Favorite food doesn't mean that they're going to munch on ultra processed foods, so no chips and all, but, you know, whatever food that they like at home, do make that. After, once they feel better, their appetite increases. So once they feel better, you want to kind of increase their food to maybe 1.5 times, because whatever that they have lost during illness, plus maintenance. Okay, so I do recommend giving 1.5 times of food. I'm going to talk a little bit, just 2-3 minutes, and I'm almost done. WHO lingo. This is, of course, a pediatrician may not know this if they're not working in public health and nutrition, but, you know, I just want to kind of go through WHO lingo. So what is minimum dietary diversity? So any 4+ breast milk. Okay, so the latest recommendation is to have basically, so these are all the different food groups. So there are 8 different food groups. It starts with breast milk, your grain, roots and tubers, legumes and nuts, your dairy products, your milk, yogurt, cheese, okay, your non-veg food, eggs, vitamin A rich fruits and vegetables, and other fruits and vegetables. Now, I don't kind of necessarily agree with this, any 4+ breast milk, absolutely yes. Because if you say any 4+, you child can have grain probably in this one, say, suppose this is one, group child is eating, and probably child is eating one legume or something. Then child eats, say, suppose vitamin A rich fruit and vegetable, and then have another fruit and vegetable. Now this, if they're eating all this 1, 2, 3, 4, and then breast milk, this will not give them enough protein. You know what I mean? I feel that protein, that the complete protein, that viable protein will not be enough in these 4 groups. So I feel that child should be eating everything. Of course, if child is non-veg, you can't, they will not eat. But then at least make sure that they have at least dairy product. You know, dairy product, I don't recommend milk starting from 6 months, but give them yogurt. Give them some paneer. Give them some, you know, ghar ka jo bhi hai. Suppose aapne kuch ghar mein banaya hai, doodh ka. You know what I mean? Once in a while, it's okay. But don't give cow milk, because that will replace mother's milk. Okay? So I recommend, I don't go by this any for, you know, minimum dietary diversity. I feel that child should be eating pretty much everything. Vegetarian children can get, it's okay not to have meat. But if they can eat one egg a day will take care of everything. Now the news says not an apple a day keeps the doctor away, it's one egg a day keeps the doctor away. This is very, very true. Minimal meal frequency for breastfed children under 6 to 8 months of age, between 6 to 8 months of age, is basically, 2 times for breastfed children. If they are a little bit older, 9 to 23 months, 3 times for breastfed children. And if they are non-breastfeeding, then basically 4 times with 2 times of cow milk, you know, 2 times of feeding in a day. Okay. Now, minimum acceptable diet, breastfed children who had at least minimum dietary diversity and minimum meal frequency. So this is how we basically, you know, when we tell government that, oh, no, children are not eating enough diet. You know, so this is what we measure. We measure that how many times children have eaten in a day, and what is the minimum dietary diversity, how many food groups that children have eaten. Okay, so this is what basically we measure. Key messages, I think I've already gone through it. But again, you know, one important thing that I like to discuss is that a lot of time mothers have this habit, as soon as child gets up in the morning, they have milk. Milk, in a sense, I'm talking about just gai ka doodh. But 1.5 saal ka ho gaya, chalo gai ka doodh de diya, subah mein uthke bada sa glass. You want to make sure that, you know, if breast milk is okay in early in the morning, but first give breakfast. You know, give breakfast, give proper meal, and then give milk. then give your breast milk. Or if you're giving cow milk, give your food first and then give milk. You know, don't make milk as a habit, because children who have too much of milk, they'll get iron deficiency anemia. I'm talking about cow milk. Okay, so just you know, make sure that, you know, we don't give too much of dairy, which will replace his mother's milk. Second problem that I've always seen is that children, say by 1.5 years of age, they have something called terrible twos. Terrible twos means terrible two ke tantrum chalu ho jata hai. Matlab, he knows that now he can control the whole world. Whole world is his mother, right? So what he's going to do, mother is giving something which is homemade. Bacha will say around 2 years of age, no, I don't want to eat this. I want to eat that. Okay, now, normally kya hota hai in the joint family where mother is there, mother-in-law is there, parents are there, father-in-law is there. Wo mother-in-law bolegi, nahi nahi, theek hai, bachche ko jo khana hai, wo de do. So what happens is, eventually mother kya karti hai ki jo usne khana bana hai, wo apna jo pure family ke liye bana hai, wo nahi deti hai. She makes a special khana for the baby. Ki nahi de. She doesn't like this, that's why I'm going to make this. So wo hum log ko nahi karna hai. We have to make sure ki we have a proper habit starting from early on, ki whatever family is eating, that food child is going to eat. Child will not have any replacement. There will be no, like, you know, it's not ki child, achha, achha, bache ko ye nahi khana hai, chalo, main usko ye bana ke deti hu. No, no, that's a wrong habit. And agar suppose child does not want to eat ghar ka khana, you make child go hungry, okay? Water is okay. Do not replace with milk or anything. Say 2 years ka bacha hai, you gave breast milk, child doesn't want to eat anything else. You say, okay, now you're going to get water. If you're not eating anything, when you feel hungry, you come back to me. So, wo jo habit hai, bahut important hai. Kitne ghante bacha bhuka rahega. And if she knows ke I'm not going to get food that I want, child will eventually learn. Right? So wo aapko, matlab, mother has to understand, father has to understand ki not to get carried away by child's anger or child's wish. Okay? Once a week, you can give whatever child wants, maybe Sunday ko, right? So that you are not depriving the child. But Monday to Saturday, mother is the boss, child gets what mother wants. Okay? So that is important. And I think this all probably I went through it. Few more things I wanted to talk about. This are complementary foods. KIC material, look at this, how you can see how thick it is. You know, this has to be very thick. There's all the different grains, seeds, you know, meat products. This is, again, you know, I wanted to show NFHS 4 data. This is 2015-2016 data. So how much states are doing? Okay, look at the Puducherry is doing the best. Okay, how many children are getting a minimum adequate diet? Remember, I talked about adequate diet, minimum adequate diet, that frequency and diet diversity. Only 31% children. And that is the best doing Union Territory. Okay, which is the worst? Rajasthan. How many children are getting minimum adequate diet? 3.4%. Can you imagine? Only 3% children are getting minimum adequate diet. You know, and I think we should do much better in Gujarat, only 5.2. We thought Punjab would be doing well, but look at Punjab, only 6% children. So if you look at the whole India data, only 9% children are getting minimum adequate diet. Okay, that is your diet diversity and your meal frequency. Okay, so we have to do that. Now, this is our helpline. So I want all the mothers and probably all the doctors to note down this number, because my team, we have a team of doctors, nutritionists, nurses, field workers, about 15 of us, you know, and we give out all, you know, if mother calls on this number, it's a toll-free number, we will call back within 24 hours and we'll provide with any assistant with nutrition of mothers, children, lactation, and adult. So even if you have any question, please call us. Adult, not much, because this is more of our Shishu Portion helpline, but pregnant mothers, yes. And one more thing is we are taking phone lines on 6 different languages. So English, Marathi, Hindi, Gujarati, Tamil, and Telugu. So if you know anybody, you know, who has any question, problems, so please ask them to call us. This is a YouTube channel, Health Spoken Tutorial. Okay, please write down this name. Health Spoken Tutorial. It is basically prepared by IITB team. Okay. And we have about 35 videos in 17-18 languages. You know, we have 35 more to go. So we are expecting about 75 to 80 tutorials. It's all about maternal, infant, young child nutrition. And of course, there are so many recipes for adults too. So please go ahead and, you know, use it. This is our, I mean, obviously more colors, better it is. So you want to have all different colors in your diet. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rupal. We will take questions now. Somehow.
Okay, I can take some. I can see some questions.
Yeah, my something got went here. Please take the questions.
Okay. Yeah, okay. So one question is, okay, I'm going to start from beginning. Example of finger foods. So example of finger foods is basically, for example, if you have a carrot, right? You just steam it a little bit, make, you know, small, long stick, you know. So you can give that stick in baby's mouth, I mean baby's hand, and they will put it in their mouth. Or suppose you have oranges, right? You peel that orange, remove that white skin, and just put it in baby's hand, they'll put it in their mouth because it's soft. So you want to think of any food which is soft, and then they can basically kind of chew on it or just bite on it. So those are your finger foods. Okay. Addition of salt or sugar. Very good. Thank you for reminding me. Thank you so much. So no salt. Till about 1 year of age, okay, the requirement is extremely, extremely low, really. So, you know, and your food has natural salt in it, okay? So, no salt till 1 year of age. Sugar and jaggery, no till 2 years of age. In fact, I would not stop at 2 years of age. I feel sugar, jaggery, no for the lifetime. Because if you can have that, you will not be afraid of COVID, okay? The reason we all are afraid of COVID, because we all are metabolically unhealthy, and metabolically unhealthy starts with insulin resistance. Okay, so if you ask me, no sugar, jaggery, no honey, you know, forget the sweet taste, forget it. Okay, all right. What are your views on milk based diet? That is plenty of milk in diet. What is good complementary feed for vegetarian? How to supply iron, zinc, copper, selenium, vitamin, and vitamin B12? Very good question. Okay, so milk based diet. So from 6 to 24 months of age, you know, basically breast milk has to be continued. So you continue your breast milk, but remember that your yogurt, your dahi, your curd has good bacteria, right? So you want to provide probiotic to the child, because that will prevent a lot of, you know, diarrhea, a lot of infection, you know, it will build child's gut microbiome. So definitely I do recommend starting curd, say from 6.5-7 months of age. Go ahead and start your yogurt. But I don't like giving cow milk, because once you start giving cow milk, mother feels ki nahi nahi abhi bas wo doodh usko mil raha hai abhi mera doodh ki, I don't need to give my milk. So I don't recommend giving a lot of cow milk. Paneer, once in a while, if you made it, please go ahead and give it. There's no problem. So, you know, I mean, there's absolutely no problem. And there are a lot of studies which have come out, which have mentioned that, you know, you can give food, you can, if you start from 6 months of age, you have less risk of getting allergies. So paneer can be definitely given. Plenty of milk in diet, no, because milk is deficient on iron. So if you're giving too much of milk, you know, the child is going to be deficient. And in the US, we do see a lot of children whose hemoglobin is 5, 6, you know, and these are all literally, they have this milk bottle in their hand all the time. They keep drinking milk. So, you know, I prefer to have a lot more nutrient dense food than just have a lot of milk, you know. Amount, how much I would give, I would not, suppose after 2 years of age, when you start giving cow milk, not more than 500 ml of dairy. So dairy means, for example, if you have given yogurt, say you have given 8 ounces of yogurt, right? 8 ounces is about 250 ml. So if you're giving 250 ml of yogurt, then only 250 ml of cow milk. You know, so you are, it's more of total dairy requirement of 500 ml, you know, rather than just giving milk 2 cups a day. Okay, so that's important. What is good complementary food? Bahut hai for vegetarians. So hai. Main thing, your pulses, your beans, जो beans होते हैं ना, जैसे मैंने germination बताया ना आपको, तो beans के साथ दूसरा आपको millet, think of millets, you know, millets are your ancient millet. I really really promote. What are your ancient millet? your barnyard millet, your kodo millet, your little millet, you know, those are very high in fiber, those are very high in mineral, those are very high in protein, and very less in carbohydrate. You know, the reason our children have so much of high triglyceride level because they are eating rice, they're eating chapati, they're eating probably banana. Everything is sugar, 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 because eventually a carbohydrate gets converted into sugar to get absorbed, right? So you promote food which are kind of low on sugar, low on carbohydrate, rich in protein, rich in fiber, rich in mineral, and then you see your child grow fast, okay? So again, and another thing, so I spoke about millets. Jawar hai, bajra hai, you know, all the other millets I spoke about. Nachni, nagli is really high in calcium, protein, right? Then look at your nuts and seeds. Your peanut. In US, people are crazy about peanut butter. And hamare Gujarat mein toh itne peanuts bante, lekin hum log peanuts bachche ke khane mein nahi dalte hai. Right? When we were growing up, we used to have peanut chana and shing hum log khate te when we were hungry. Now what do they eat? They have chips. They have all this, you know, juice. They'll have some rubbish like Pediasure, you know. So add those nuts and seeds in your food, right? If parents are open to it, one egg a day, I promise one egg a day will keep a doctor away for sure, you know. But do promote egg if you can. Vitamin B12. Now, if you germinate your pulses, your beans, you know, a lot of time they basically your gut microbiome. If you have a good gut microbiome, it will produce vitamin B12. Okay. So when an adult who is eating non-veg food, they also have a lot more vitamin B12 deficiency, because if they're eating a lot more sugar and junk food, that will kill your good bacteria. Okay, so for absorption of vitamin B12, you require a very strong, healthy gut. So keep your gut healthy and you won't have vitamin B12 deficiency, because we have a lot of vegetarians who don't have vitamin B12 deficiency. It's more about the gut health. Okay, zinc, pumpkin seeds. Your pumpkin seeds, your bhopale ka beej, please tell mothers, they give children pumpkin, bhopale dete, lekin bhopale ka beej fake dete, right? Those beej jo hai, seeds are very high in zinc. So that's why I promote a lot of those seeds, you know, in child's diet. Okay. Copper again, you will see a lot more in nuts and seeds. Selenium is another one which is very good for immunity, you know. So some of your nuts are very high in selenium. Okay. So think about that. Another thing which is very good, which I recommend, is cruciferous vegetables. You know, cruciferous, which is your cauliflower, your cabbage, you know. If you have access to broccoli, those are cruciferous vegetables. Okay, they are mineral rich. They have protein, good amount of protein. They have a high amount of sulfur, you know. So please have, we always think of potato. Potato dal diya, ispe aloo mein sab sabji mein aloo. Aloo means potatoes, right? So we want to get rid of like a lot of these potatoes, you know. Potatoes are nothing but carbohydrate. It has a little bit of potassium, but main thing, you get your minerals from your leafy vegetables, from your grains, from your, you know, millets. Okay. Malted food. So malted foods, yes. So I discussed this malted food in my presentation. So what you do is basically you soak your millets, or you soak your pulses, I'm talking about beans, right? Once you soak it, then you germinate it. Once you germinate it, then you basically roast it or dry it, roast it. Once you roast it, then you make a flour. Okay. Those are your malted flours, malted foods. That is called malting. We have shown beautifully in our videos all these malted food recipes. So when you look at our recipes for 6 months old, 7 months old, even for pregnant mothers, everything is made from malted flour. Because we believe that if you malt it, you know, it will improve your gut microbiome. It will improve the absorption of nutrients. It will decrease the phytic acid, oxalic acids. You know, basically your food will become like amrit, you know. So the malting is really, really important. Thanks for asking that question. Can you talk about choline? Yes, thank you, Apurva. Apurva is my student at IIT Bombay, and we had very good, you know, presentation on choline requirement. Choline is one nutrient which a lot of doctors don't know, okay? Because probably we were not given a lot of education and nutrition. It is required basically for neural tube formation, Okay. If you remember doctors, pediatricians, acetylcholine. You remember acetylcholine, right? That choline comes, acetylcholine. So that acetylcholine ka choline comes from your choline rich food. Now, which foods are high in choline? And not only it helps with neural tube, it helps with cognition, it helps with memory, it helps with fatty liver disease, it prevents the fatty liver disease, it is anti-inflammatory, it has too many effects. I can take 2 hour lecture on just choline. Okay, so let's not go too much in detail. Which foods are high in choline? Egg is very high in choline, cauliflower. So, you know, a lot of your cruciferous vegetables are high in choline. Okay, so that's why we do recommend, make sure that when you make anything out of cauliflower, don't have raw, because it has goitrogens. So, you know, just cook it and then have it. Anything, please cook it. Don't have anything which is raw. Okay, so choline is very important, not just for adults also. How should we give the flax seeds? So flax seeds, basically what you can do is to just roast it a little bit. Don't roast too much, you know, because it has oil. So you don't want to roast it too much, just little bit, and then you can have it with dahi. Okay, for children, what you can do, what we have made a flaxseed powder. So we have used 3-4 different nuts and seeds powder, and then you can put it in children's khichdi and then add a little bit of dahi. Because remember I told you, with any of this nuts and seeds, you need to have some calcium rich food. Okay, and dahi is one of the best calcium rich food, so that, you know, children don't absorb too much of oxalates. Okay, physiological iron deficiency seen at 6 weeks. Do we need to No. We don't supplement 6 weeks old children. Okay, we don't. What I do recommend is that mothers are supplemented. Pregnant, lactating mothers who are basically lactating, you please supplement those. This is a type 1 micronutrient. So if you increase the level of iron in breast milk, you know, child will be protected. But what I really recommend, that you please talk to all your OBGYN colleagues and tell them to, you know, not to cut cord right away, to basically let it stop pulsating and then cut it, you know. So that is the latest recommendation by WHO. Role of lactase in diarrhea. You know, the thing is, I don't recommend. We in US, we don't recommend any of this, really. Diarrhea in US, and of course in India also, ORS, zinc, breast milk, and your nutrient-dense complementary food. Really, you know, and of course you can give some dahi and all, but I don't recommend, like, because it's a very temporary. It's probably a one, you know, it will last. If you have a chronic diarrhea, if you have diarrhea for 2 weeks, then you will have a lactase problem. You know, you'll have a child will become lactose intolerant. But if it is few days here and there, and then believe me, once you start zinc, the children, they come out so fast. In our program, we work in, urban slum where diarrhea was so common. But once we worked on their nutrition, once the breast milk went, when the effective latching improved, when complementary food improved, we just stopped seeing diarrheas. We just don't see diarrhea. Now these children, some of them, Dr. Sanwar, you have seen our growth charts. They're 97th percentile for length. And these are slum children. So what I feel is that, you know, I won't recommend any of this probiotic, you know, ye do, wo do. I don't believe in it, really. It's simple food, simple advice, mother's milk, you know, complementary food, good. That's it. Main is to prevent it. What is it? Common type 2 deficiency. I don't understand this. Type 2 deficiency is all the type 2 nutrients which are required for growth. Okay, so what are the type 2 nutrients? Your protein, your essential amino acids, okay, your essential fatty acids, which is required in your food for child to grow, which is your omega-3 and omega-6, okay, then your magnesium, potassium, sodium, chloride, zinc, sulfur, those are type 2 micronutrients. So, you know, again, that's another lecture by itself. Those type 2 micronutrients, but we have a very good video on health spoken tutorial and type 2 micronutrient deficiency. So please go ahead and see it. You will see everything. I feel while introducing complementary food, we should be careful introduce only one food at a time to check in. Yes, very true. Very true. So this is, I've mentioned in my presentation that you introduce one food at a time. Although I have not seen to date any study which said you have to do it. So there is no science, it's not evidence-based advice, to be frank. I've not seen any scientific study saying that you have to introduce one food at a time, okay? But just maybe common sense to you want to introduce, because if you introduce four things at a time, you will not know if child had some rash, you won't know whether it came from rajma, or it came from peanut, or it came from sesame seed, or it came from, right? So it makes sense to introduce one at a time. As you said, the viability of vegetarian food is poor, so how to meet iron need? So as I said, the iron need, do those cooking techniques, okay? You introduce food which are high in iron, then you basically use a cooking methodology of soaking, roasting, germinating, fermenting, all that will improve. And if you eat egg and non-veg, your liver is one good source of but you're talking about vegetarian, so that's okay. But it's mainly, use your cooking technique and decrease your phytate level, decrease your oxalate level in your food. Okay. Please, can you flash light on iron as connection went off? Okay, I'll come back to it later. Would addition of nuts extra present? No. Okay, so there's a beautiful study which came out. Okay. It came out probably 2 years ago. I will share it with Dr. Samar, and maybe you can share that study with doctors. And they said that what they did, they took all the food which were high allergenic, okay, and they started giving this food to starting from 4 to 6 months, 6 to 8 months, 8 to 9. They had a category. So they found that children who had this allergenic food early on, they had less chance of getting allergies, at 1 year of age. So now the recommendation has changed completely. Like before, we used to say no egg white till 1 year of age, no yay, no nuts, no this. But when US started doing that, they started seeing very high prevalence of peanut allergy. So I would recommend that just go with this latest recommendation and start pretty much everything and anything from 6 months of age, except for seafood. Shellfish, no. Because shellfish, they had not included shellfish in that. Okay. Sprouts with white part to be included. Yes. So she's mentioning that sprouts, which has this white sprouts, should be included. Yes, it should be. You can remove the cover. You can remove the cover, but definitely, because when you're cooking it, those are growing parts, right? It's actively growing. Means they are extremely healthy. Boiled apple can be given. I to be frank, I don't start fruit till 9 months of age, 9, 10 months of age. What happens when you start fruit too early on? Children get taste of the sweet sugar taste. It's sugar basically, right? And then it becomes so difficult to start any new food. So what I do is I recommend you start all the different foods. You start Kerala first. Make children learn to enjoy those different tastes, and then start your apple, your banana, maybe after 10 months, 9 months, 10 months. You know what I mean? Another thing is that I recommend to have, like when you're making any food, the kacha banana, kacha kela is much healthier because much higher in potassium. It's very less on carbohydrate, very less on sugar. So you're getting this nutrient-dense food. It has resistant starch, right? So you're feeding your gut microbiome, right? So all this thing is very important. You remember, sir, I think I had taken a lecture on gut microbiome, right? Where I had
Yes.
spoken about the importance of this bacteria, which is trillions of bacteria in your gut, right? So you want to feed those bacteria. But what you feed, you will get that result. If you feed sugar, you will get all sugar-loving bacteria. And that sugar-loving bacteria is going to cause havoc. It's going to cause problem metabolic disorders, right? But if you feed food which is, less sugar, much more high fiber, dense, nutrient dense, diet diversity, you're going to basically create a beautiful flora, gut flora, and it's going to give you health. It's going to improve your cognition. Child's cognition will be high. Child memory will be good. What more do we want? Why are we obsessed with sugar? I don't understand. Okay, so I think that's important. Okay, can we have a copy of this presentation? Yes, of course. Comment on cause of early incidence of prediabetes. Comment, yes. Prediabetes, what I've noticed, most of the mothers, they add fruit in every food. खिचड़ी में भी एप्पल प्योरी डाला, यू नो कुछ स्पिनच में उसमें भी बनाना प्योरी डाला. एवरी फूड यू वी आर एडिंग फ्रूट फ्रूट फ्रूट. ओके वन फ्रूट थोड़ा सा लिटिल बिट आफ्टर द मील एज अ डिजर्ट इज ओके. But if you are adding fruit too many fruits, if you are giving only rice, क्योंकि you know हमारा culture है ना rice पानी चालू करो, चावल चालू किया, चावल. What is चावल? चावल is ultra refined, you know, lacking fiber, carbohydrate. It's a starch. Now what is happening to the starch? Starch doesn't get absorbed directly. Starch gets converted into your glucose molecule, right? So we are bombarding our children every 2 hours with food which is rice, which is high in starch, right? Your potato, all the children, they love potato. Why do we expose children to potato at all? I don't understand. Because if you're exposing child to potato, you know, that's your starch, child is never going to have nutrient-dense food like spinach. How many children will say, nahi, nahi, mujhe bhaji bahut achhi lagti hai, mujhe bahut spinach bahut achha lagta hai. Who will say, nahi, mujhe potato achha nahi lagta hai. So the thing is, starch is, because it tastes so good, it is addicting, you know? So it's important that we basically focus now more on protein and good fats. Okay. Should the sprout, okay, that I spoke about it. Can you share the link? Yes. You view on vegan diet for baby. Oh, no vegan diet. Absolutely not. Okay. Because some amount of vitamin B12 and the thing child will get from, you know, yogurt or, you know, your dairy. If you're not having even yogurt and paneer, you know, that vegan diet will cause a problem. In fact, Dr. Samar, you must be knowing, we are seeing a lot more tremors and, you know, cognition problems. You know, we are not even looking at vitamin B12 deficiency. You know what I mean? So, and those are, some of them are lifelong. Okay. So please do not have vegan diet for babies at all. It's not at all recommended. Palak is rich in oxalate. Yes. So palak is rich in oxalate. Please cook it, you know, and you have it with dahi. So you can have it with either buttermilk, you know, or with dahi. So just add with dahi. If the child is having diarrhea, then shall we go lactose free? No, if a child has diarrhea just for a week or so, they are not lactose intolerant. I'm talking about children who have chronic diarrhea for some other different conditions, you know, like 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Those are the ones who go lactose intolerant. For acute diarrhea, you don't need to go lactose free at all. I'm talking about 6 months to 2 years of age, even older children, you know. But of course, dahi will help. So I do recommend giving a lot more dahi when children have diarrhea. Should probiotic to be added to cereal? Yes, probiotic, you can add your dahi. Okay, dahi is the best probiotic. I don't recommend any you know, commercial product. I think dahi is one of the best. And if you're giving really good prebiotic, your prebiotic is your fiber. So if you're giving millets are high in prebiotic. Amazing amount of fiber. You know, your lentils, you know, your pulses, your dals has such good fiber. Right? And those are prebiotic. So don't go with commercial prebiotic and probiotic. Okay? Talk about cashew nut. Yes, cashew nut. Yes. This is from my mentor, Dr. Ratna Thar. Okay, whatever I've learned from her. So cashew is extremely high in zinc. Extremely high, you know. So a lot of time, you know, there was a question about zinc. We have in, you know, a lot of this kind of middle class children, when they have poor appetite, what we tell mothers to give them some cashew nuts, you know, and stop all the junk food, like, you know, your biscuits and chips and all. With once that zinc goes in, you know, that child immediately has tremendous appetite, and then basically, you know, give them type 2 nutrient rich food. So absolutely, cashew nut is, it's definitely the must. What age can we start nut powder and paste? 6 months. So you can start your nut powder paste all that from 6 months on, 6 completion. So you don't have to wait till 9 months, 10 months, 1 year of age. Start as soon as possible. Okay, can we add spices, turmeric? Yes, we can use spices in our food. In a sense, from 6 months onward, the spices are extremely high in minerals. Okay, they are high in magnesium, potassium, zinc, selenium. So, you know, if child can tolerate, you can have a little bit of turmeric in there. You can put a little bit of dhania powder, jeera powder. Absolutely. There's no doubt about it. Okay. You can even have some, you know, basically sprout your methi seeds, you know, then crush it and you can put that. No problem. No salt. Baki ka kuch bhi chalega. Thanks for mentioning vitamin C rich food. Yes. So, in case of diarrhea, zinc is beneficial. So, in which form? So, normally WHO recommends zinc sulfate. Okay. And you have a dose already. Basically, you know, you're more than 6 months, 20 milligram per day, once a day for 2 weeks. Less than, 6 months is your 10 milligram once a day for 2 weeks. So, your zinc sulfate. It is also available in primary healthcare centers. Idea of starting biscuit with milk. Oh, not at all. Biscuit is ultra processed, ultra junk food, sugar and maida. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Huh? No Mari, no biscuit, no Parle G. Absolutely. And I would not recommend even for adults. Okay. Okay, so they want lecture on gut microbiome next time, maybe, sir. Because gut microbiome is another lecture by itself. Okay, now one question is, does sprout gives gas? Yes, sprout does not give gas, but if you give your food which is high in phytates, you know, if you don't process it, it will give you gas. Because phytic acid is anti-nutrient, you know. Phytic acid is there so that, you know, animals don't eat that food. Right, so it is basically, if you have anything which is phytate oxalate, it will give you gas, and that's why I mentioned to basically process that food. So when you sprout it, when you ferment it, you will not get gas, promise. Okay. If in stool RS is present, should we avoid all fruits? And you know, the thing is, for me, no, fruit is dessert, okay, and that too once in a while. So if I have access to fruit, maybe once in 2-3 days, little bit of fruit piche de diya, that's okay. But I'm not very pro fruitarian diet for children, you know, because then again the triglyceride level will rise. You know, we don't want, it's a fructose, you know, basically it's fructose, right? So and fructose goes directly into liver. You know, it does not get absorbed in the, it goes directly into liver, and basically that it gets converted into triglyceride. Okay, and with that, 33% children 5 to 9 years of age with high triglyceridemia, like, you know, we should definitely be very careful with fruits. You know, one fruit little bit after food is okay. Okay, so I think, sir, I think almost done. Dr. Sawar.
Gotcha.
Lot of them wants a microbiome lecture. So later.
Yeah, we'll do it later sometime if you're free, and we have a lot of time in the lockdown again. So I would thank you, Professor Rupal, for your excellent talk. I have always enjoyed interacting with you, and you are full of energy, like the energy dense food you recommend. So thank you very much for your excellent talk, and we hope to have you again on our group meeting sometime on the gut microbiome.
Yes, sir. One more thing I just wanted to show them before I leave. I wanted to show them hold on, sir. I'll just, I want to show them my video so that they can see it. Okay. So here, this is on YouTube. So you can go on YouTube. And then basically, health spoken tutorial. Okay. So you can go on health spoken tutorial and you can subscribe over here, and then just keep the notification on so that anytime we have new video, you know, you will see, you will get the notification. And here, if you click on it, this is our logo of health spoken tutorial, IIT Bombay. So here, we have basically all the different languages. This is English tutorial. We have about 35 English tutorials. Then all the different languages, Marathi, Gujarati, Kokani, Hindi. We have about 30 videos. So if you suppose, for example, if you click on Hindi tutorial, okay, just to show you, this is on cross-cradle, this thing, but here on the side, here, these are all the different topics, and you can see there are 30 videos. So just go down and here, the importance of magnesium, type 1, type 2. Here, this is a type 1, type 2 nutrient that I mentioned, which everybody should watch it, because, you know, a lot of questions were there on type 2 nutrients. So what are type 2, type 1? How do you get it? Calcium rich, non-rich, vitamin C, uncooked recipes. And here, I want to come back to vegetarian recipes. So vegetarian recipes for 7-month-old, vegetarian recipes for 6-months-old, powder recipes, which I was mentioning about. This is a really good, you know, video where we have shown.
जैसे 24 महीने के शिशुओं के लिए पौष्टिक पाउडर बनाने के तरीकों के स्पोकन ट्यूटोरियल में आपका स्वागत है. इस ट्यूटोरियल में हम सीखेंगे कई पौष्टिक पाउडर बनाने के तरीके, जैसे कि अमाइलेज पाउडर, सिर्फ बीजों का पाउडर, दाने और बीजों का पाउडर, फलियों का पाउडर, कड़ी पत्तों का पाउडर और सहजन के पत्तों का पाउडर.
Okay.
इन सभी पौष्टिक पाउडरों को घर पर आसानी से बनाया जा सकता है.
Okay, so again coming back, so just wanted to show that you know, link to our tutorial, because literally I believe in self-learning. So more you learn on your own, you know, and then we can have session on just question answers, you know. But but anything else I can do, Dr. Sagar, let me know.
The popular demands seem to be gut microbiome, so we'll plan for that sometime in future. And extremely thankful to you for a very, very lucid and excellent presentation. I've gone through your videos of supplement foods and breastfeeding, and I've recommended to many children and their families, and they find it extremely useful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. There is one more. There are two more junk food, which every mother should watch it. Not mother, the whole family. Because the junk food has become so prevalent, you know, and that is causing, if we didn't have junk food, we would not have been scared of COVID, I think, you know. We would have had such good immunity that we would have fought off all the infections, whatever may come, right? But I feel that if we can get rid of one thing, literally, or two things, one is sugar, another thing, junk food. So that's, I just wanted to pass that last message to everybody. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Rupal. We'll end the meeting now. Thanks for your time and your excellent talk.
Thank you, sir. Bye.
Thanks a lot. Bye.
Thank you, everybody. Yeah, bye.